I found a cool YouTube channel that does a chord breakdown for various songs, and one of the songs was Circle of Life from The Lion King by Elton John. And it's such a great song, and the chords are so interesting, and I thought it'd be worth sharing with you what I got out of analyzing the chords to that song, Circle of Life by Elton John. The song is in the key of B flat. So we know the chords that are going to be available to us normally that will sound right are going to be, of course, the tonic B flat, and then C minor, then D minor, then E flat, then F, and G minor, A diminished, and then we'd be back to B flat again. What I'm saying is we would expect to see these chords in the progression of the song. In any key, the normal chords that we will find are the chords taken from in the case of major, a major scale. So the first one's going to be a major, second one minor, then another minor, then a major, major, minor, then a diminished, and then finally back to the tonic. So those are the chords we're going to use to construct Circle of Life, plus a couple of additions that he makes that make it sound really cool. Okay, so that first line of the intro, I've rewritten it up here on the whiteboard, and I'm going to play the piano to it. You don't need to see how the chords are formed yet, just so you can hear what's going on. So the first is B flat, the next one is G minor, the next one is C minor, the next one is F suspend the fourth, is what that means. So instead of playing the third in the middle, we would play the fourth. And then it resolves back to F. So here's how F suspend the fourth sounds, and then the resolve to F. Okay, right off the bat here in the intro, we immediately see one of the tricks he uses is that suspension of the fourth to give it some tension, so that we like the sound of it, but we're happy when it resolves. We like this okay, but it's definitely tense. You can hear that. And then the resolve, and it drops a semitone. And the reason that works so well is that the fourth note of F is B flat, which is also the key that the song is in, and it's the one we want to always get back to. So that F suspend fourth down to resolving to the F is a really great trick. He uses it right away in the first line of the intro. I'll play this whole thing for you again. Now we're to the second line of the intro. It's almost the same, but not exactly. A couple of key differences. The first one is B flat, but you add the ninth. Well, what's the ninth note of a B flat scale? It's C natural. So we're going to be playing B flat with a C natural on top. Then G minor stays the same. Then C minor, seven. Okay, well, how do you form that? You take C minor and you add the seventh note, which in this case, because it's a C minor 7, will be B flat. So notice that we're adding to this chord the same note that the key for the song is. And that B flat keeps coming up because that's what we want to hear. So this time through, he's added the 7. Then again, the F suspend the fourth to give you the tension and the F to resolve. I'll play these for you. The first one is B flat, add the ninth. See, then we go to G minor. Same as the last time. This time C minor 7, and the 7 is the B flat, so now you'll hear that in there. And then back to the F suspend the fourth, and then the F. So again, at pace, here's what it sounds like. Okay, here we are on the first line of the first verse of the song. And again, because in the key of B flat, that's the root. But he adds the ninth again, getting us used to that C. This symbol notation here means play a C minor, but play B flat in the bass. Now, if you think about that, that's a little bit dissonant, and you'll hear it when I play it. But what he's doing is he's holding us at B flat, but moving along on the melody line through C minor. Then the next one is F7 over an A, which means you play F7 in your right hand with an A bass. So if you look at what the bass is doing, it's gone from C here, which is the ninth of the B flat, to B flat, and then down to A. So the bass is walking down. And at the same time, the melody is moving up from B flat to C to F. So here, it's only a semitone down from B flat. We drop the bass to A, but we play F7 over it. And then finally, we go back home to B flat, but we keep the 9 in there because he wants to keep that melody going. I'll play the chords for you. The first one is B flat, and then add the 9th. The second one is C minor over a B flat, so I keep my left hand the same on the B flat, and I play C minor on top of it. And even though that's a little bit odd, it sounds cool, doesn't it? Then the next one is F7 with an A on the bass. So I drop the bass by a half step and play F7 on top. And then the last one's back to B. Okay, here's how it sounds at speed.
There's more to be seen than can never be seen. More to do than can never be done.
Okay, now we're on to the next part of the verse, where he's using more of the chords that are available to us in the key of B flat. Starting with G minor, adds the 7, then C minor, again adds the 7, then A flat, but adds the 9th. So in A flat, the 9th note is B flat. And so that, of course, takes us back to the key. And then he comes down to F again, but then he moves to F7 over an A. That's what all that symbology means. And so, by the way, when you see a slash 9, that means add 9, because the 9 is a number. But if you see a slash A, a letter, that means play the first chord you see, and then in the bass, instead of playing an F for a bass as you normally would, play whatever it says, in this case an A. All right, so here's what these chords sound like. G minor 7, you play a G minor with a 7 on top. Here's how it sounds. Okay, then a C minor 7, same concept, but in C. Then an A flat, but add the 9th, so we'll stick a B flat in there. And then we'll go back to F. And then we're starting to move somewhere, so now we're going to move up with our left hand to A on the bass, and also add in an E flat for an F7. And okay, so here's the whole thing. This line, anyway, at a speed, starting with G minor 7.
Some say eat or be eaten. Some say live and let live. But all our to join the stampede, you should never take more than you give.
Okay, the next section of the song is basically a repeat, so I won't go through it here. There's some small changes, but they're not significant.
In the circle of life,
here's the chords from the first part of the chorus. They're B flat, then E flat over a B flat, and back to B flat, then A flat over B flat, then E flat, A flat over an E flat, then E flat, and then F over an E flat. So what's going on here? We start out with the B flat, and then we switch to an E flat over a B flat. So that means we first play the B flat, Then we play an E flat on our right hand and leave the bass at B flat. Here's what it sounds like. And then we come back to B flat. So we've never moved our left hand at all. Now we're going to play an A flat over B flat. So once again, we're not moving our left hand, but now we're up to A flat. And you can hear the cool dissonance there. That's going to resolve to just a normal E flat. So I'll have to finally move my left hand up to E flat and just play an E flat. But he's going to pull the same trick he did at the beginning of this, where he wants me to play an A flat over an E flat back to an E flat. So what really happens here is my left hand stays on E flat all three times, and what's happening is I'm moving between E flat, A flat, and back to E flat. So here's what it would sound like. The E flat, then the A flat over an E flat, and then an E flat. And if you listen to that, that's a classic Elton John maneuver. You've heard it in many, many songs. Anyway, then finally he resolves the right hand to an F chord, but he keeps the E flat going because we're only halfway through the chorus, so he's not done yet. So that's an F over an E flat. That means I get to keep my left hand on E flat, and I just play an F chord. And you can hear that something's building here because it's very dissonant, but it sounds cool and you can tell something's coming. So let me run through this just as it's written there. Chorus he was building to. The setup here is B flat over a D. That sounds like we play a D in the bass and then a B flat on top. So you can hear that doesn't sound like a B flat because of this D. And the D is basically changing the key on us now, because the next chord we play is G7, which is not in the B flat chords that we could choose from. So he's really trying to force us into D here, and then we're going to go to G7, which sounds like this, and that'll be over a G because it doesn't say otherwise. And you'll recognize that from the tune if you can recall it right now. Then we go back into C minor 7, which is back in the B flat chord structure. So we're already out of that key change to D. And here's the most interesting chord of all. It's a G flat, add 6, add 9. It's a G flat chord, which is completely out of our structure of B flat, but we also add the 6 and the 9th. G flat sounds like this, and then adding the 6th, and then adding the 9th. And that's a classic dissonant chord that Elton does. A whole lot of change there, but the reason he does it is to get that G flat in there so that he can then lower the bass down to F, just a semitone, and play the B flat on top. So here's what that goes to. And so you're only, that F, which you really hear well, is only a half step from that. So he's basically forcing us to G flat, so we hear that drop, but over a major chord, so it sounds cool. And then back down to F. Then we slide up to E flat over a B flat, and all this is a way to get down to B flat. And that ends the chorus. So to play this thing at a pace, you know, starts out with B flat over a D and then goes to G7 like this. That's a quick recap of how to play the chords to Circle of Life by Elton John, and gives you, I hope, a little bit of insight into how clever he is and how, well, frankly, genius those chord movements are. And maybe if you study others of his songs, you'll see similar tricks that he's using. And what you find as you do that is that's what makes his songs so almost immediately memorable. You don't have to hear it 5 to 10 times to have it drilled into you to like it. As soon as you hear it, you catch what he's doing and you dig it. I was very excited when I ran across this video. I thought of you immediately and I couldn't wait to share it with you. Hope you're doing well.